The nearest man might come to paradise on earth is in a garden. A space conceived, ordered, planned, and planted for his refreshment and delight. From the walled gardens of the Orient to the formal gardens of the Renaissance, gardens were made to the measure of man. In gardens designed by man, controlled by man, raw nature was subdued and tamed. But the ornate frame with which former ages divided nature wild from nature tamed was in the Romantic age brusquely swept aside. To the Romantics, boundaries around nature signaled boundaries to experience, boundaries to the imagination. The Romantics stepped out of the contrived frame and, leaving behind them nature clipped and well-behaved, sought out nature in the wild. The wilder, the better.
The poetry of William Wordsworth signals the urgency of this new relationship of man to nature. Nature assumes the power that religion had for earlier ages. Nature becomes
the anchor of my purest thoughts, the nurse, the guide, the guardian of my heart and soul of all my moral being. To look on nature, not as in the hour of thoughtless youth, but hearing oftentimes the still sad music of humanity, nor harsh nor grating, but of ample power to chasten and subdue. And I have felt a presence that disturbs me with the joy of elevated thoughts, a sense sublime of something far more deeply interfused, whose dwelling is the light of setting suns, and the round ocean, and the living air, and the blue sky, and in the mind of man. A motion and a spirit that impels all thinking things, all objects of all thought, and rolls through all things.
The formal garden of the early 18th century, a testament to man-made order. Each tree is made reasonable, pruned by a gardener who is more like a barber, and who leaves the tree with no rebellious branches, no unruly foliage. His trees bear a form as sleek and controlled as the wig of an 18th century aristocrat. For the Romantics, the formal garden represents everything that has gone wrong in life, testifying not to elegance but to distortion, constriction, repression. Victor Hugo voices their feelings.
Just compare the royal garden at Versailles. Well contoured, well pruned, well tended, well raked, well graveled, full of little waterfalls, bronze tritons ceremoniously frolicking on seas, pumped at great expense from the Seine, captive waters diverted from their course, framed by a host of conical yew trees, cylindrical laurels, spherical orange trees, trees whose natural shape had undoubtedly been deemed too trivial and therefore gracefully corrected by the gardener's shears. Compare this with the primitive forest and choose between the gardener's masterpiece and the work of nature, between conventional beauty and beauty devoid of rules, between an artificial literature and the poetry of originality. Choose between classical and romantic. Choose between classical and romantic.
Like Rousseau, Chateaubriand discovers the pleasures of solitude and reverie. Reverie, the imaginative melting of man into nature. Chateaubriand longs for wild nature, for nature untainted by civilization. He journeys to America and plunges into the wilderness of virgin forest that he finds there, not to make discoveries, but to affirm his freedom.
I entered woods which had never seen an axe, and I was seized by a sort of intoxication of independence. Here are no more roads or cities, or monarchy or republic, or presidents or kings, or men.
emptiness, the bleakness of wild seas, fierce rocks, barren landscapes, becomes immensely appealing.
O'Shea's fairest in her features wild, where nothing polished dare pollute her path. To me, by day or night she ever smiled, though I have marked her when none other hath, and sought her more and more, and loved her best in wrath.
The tempest becomes the outward sign of inner storm, of inner torment. Coleridge's ancient mariner travels across a sea whose changing face reflects his changing states of soul. Storm turns to stagnant calm. Broiling heat gives way to solid seas of ice.
With sloping masts and dipping prow, as who pursued with yell and blow, still treads the shadow of his foe and forward bends his head. The ship drove fast, loud roared the blast, and southward aye we fled. And now there came both mist and snow, and it grew wondrous cold. And ice, mast high, came floating by, as green as emerald. And through the drifts the snowy cliffs did send a dismal sheen, nor shapes of men nor beasts we knew, the ice was all between. The ice was here, the ice was there, the ice was all around. It cracked and growled and roared and howled like noises in a swound.
Landseer's grim painting makes clear this new world order in which natural forces mock man's puny efforts at domination or control. Marking the failure of a polar expedition, the title is Man Proposes, God Disposes. In the relationship between man and nature, landscape becomes a state of soul. An earlier generation had looked upon mountains as Earth's dishonor, an encumbering load. The romantic, however, finds in mountains something of the moral grandeur of the universe. Rousseau points the way, upwards.
It is a general experience common to all men, though not all are aware of it, that high up in the mountains, where the air is pure and rarefied, one is conscious of a greater ease in breathing, a greater sense of physical lightness, a greater mental serenity, an attenuation of pleasure and of passion. Up here, in keeping with the sights around us, our thoughts assume a certain vague, sublime grandiosity, a certain vague, voluptuous charm, quite devoid of harsh sensuality. It is as if all low, earthly feelings were left behind us as we rise above the human level, and as we draw nigh to the ethereal realms, the soul absorbs something of their eternal purity.
Scenes that caused previous travelers to shudder and draw down the blinds of their carriages were eagerly sought out by the romantic painters and writers, and by a wider public following in their train. Wordsworth celebrates the bleak beauty of a mountain landscape.
The immeasurable height of woods decaying, never to be decayed, the stationary blasts of waterfalls, and in the narrow rent at every turn, winds thwarting winds, bewildered and forlorn. The torrent shooting from the clear blue sky, the rocks that muttered close upon our ears, black, drizzling crags that spake by the wayside as if a voice were in them. Characters of the great apocalypse, the types and symbols of eternity, of first and last and midst and without end.
The Romantics do not strive to improve nature. They collaborate with her. Wordsworth writes his finest poems inspired by nature. Through their response to nature, Friedrich, Constable, and Turner transform the visual arts. While in his songs, Schubert finds equivalents for nature.
Tears that flow like a torrent. The hero's heart that beats like the tops of the trees crushed by the wind. A pain as strong as granite. Roaring torrents, rustling forests, menacing rocks. This is where I live.
In their rejection of reason and intellect, the Romantics bring their hearts and their genius to nature, creating an immense inventory of new thoughts, new emotions, new concepts. Nothing is left out. All can be accommodated. From the vast epic of Mont Blanc to the sad rhyme of a dead leaf. For Goethe's romantic hero, Werther, nature becomes synonymous with God.
When the vapors of the valley rise up before me, when the sun launches its fire into the dark vault of my black forest, and when the delicate rays ease into my sanctuary, I discover in the density of the grass a kingdom of unknown plants. In this intricate universe of grass and flower, worm and bee, I feel the strength of the all-powerful, the all-loving, who sustains us, rising on a sea of eternal delight.
Wordsworth, as for Werther, the wilderness pulses with meaning.
Ye presences of nature in the sky and on the earth, ye visions of the hills and souls of lonely places, can I think a vulgar hope was yours when ye employed such ministry? When ye, through many a year, haunting me thus among my boyish sports, on caves and trees, upon the woods and hills, impressed upon all forms the characters of danger or desire, and thus did make the surface of the universal earth with triumph and delight, with hope and fear, work like a sea.
domestic garden could not accommodate this new thirst for mountain, avalanche, ocean. And the development of a garden that can be termed romantic involved an extraordinary paradox. The owners of the great estates, themselves touched by the spirit of the romantics and their dedication to the perfect liberty of the individual and of nature, nevertheless, enclosed nature. But they strive to reconstitute a virgin nature on their own ground and on their own terms. The park at Stowe, one of the great English gardens. But is this the romantic garden? Carefully evoking the gentle melancholy of Goethe's poem set to music by Schubert, a park is broken up, at great expense, into irregular and unexpected vistas. Artificial ruins are dotted around in order to stimulate poetic reverie. Of the Hermitage in Bayreuth, the romantic hero becomes a sentimental hero. Surrounded by gardens known in France and Germany as English gardens, but in fact imitated from Rousseau's admired descriptions of landscape in La Nouvelle Héloïse. In this kind of romantic garden, the romantic lord or lady can play at being in nature. Artificial nature, artificial grottos, artificial solitude.
I love all waste and solitary places, where we taste the pleasure of believing what we see is boundless, as we wish our souls to be.
L'amour croit s'il s'inquiète, il s'endort s'il est content. L'amour croit s'il s'inquiète, il s'endort s'il est content.
the gardens at Vaux-le-Vicomte. In the classical garden, there was no room for melancholy. People were dancing, playing blind man's buff, setting sail for the fabulous island of Cythera. Jean-Jacques Rousseau composed an opera, The Village Soothsayer, that was performed at Fontainebleau before Louis XV. Paradox began long before the imitation waterfalls. In the pastoral charades of Marie Antoinette, the royalty dress up as milkmaids. But Marie Antoinette's exquisite folly, the creamery in the mock dairy at Rambouillet, is nothing more than a pastoral conceit. In the romantic garden, the artlessness of nature is carefully studied with reference not to nature, but rather to the improved version of nature offered in paintings and poetry. The privileged owner of the garden is shielded from confrontation with real life, real nature. It is unlikely that in this protected environment he will ever stub his toe on a stone.
Here, spacious ponds. There, soft imperial bowers. Here, silver fountains. There, aspiring towers, whose cloud-surrounded tops so high ascend, they seem in the cerulean sky to end. Next I behold the beauties of the plain, where painted flowers in gay profusion reign. Here, brindled deer, there, fleecy lambkins feed, and grace promiscuously the verdant mead. O'er hills and dales to roam, and trace the windings of the tuneful grove, where echo dwells midst sweet exhaling briars, and joins the concerts of the feathered choirs. Every object strikes my wondering sight with such a vast profusion of delight that I, like some enchanted traveller, tossed from scene to scene, rove on till fancy's lost.
Here is none of the malevolent power of raw nature celebrated in the works of Byron, Shelley, and Wordsworth. These gardens are delightful playgrounds of artifice and caprice. At this turning point of European sensibility, the cult of beauty is also the cult of the sense of loss, of having lost forever that perfect beauty for which it yearns. A cult not of confident celebration, but of regret, sadness, and nostalgia for a lost paradise. In Sylvie, the romantic novelist Gérard de Nerval describes the park at Ermenonville, where Rousseau is buried, and mourns the loss of the paradise gardens of his childhood. A paradise now as irrevocably lost as that of Milton.
As I crossed the lake by the crumbling bridge, all at once I recollected the path where my uncle would accompany me on childhood walks. We used to pass by the Temple of Philosophy, which its creator had not had time to finish before he died. How solitary is all this now, and how sad. Here once more are the poplars that guard the island, and here the tomb of Rousseau, emptied of his ashes. You have given us the chance to live fully, and we are too weak to profit by it.
At Ermenonville, the facade of the Temple of Philosophy. Nothing lies behind it. The romantic garden is studded with mock facades, mock temples, and mock ruins inherited from the caprices of the Rococo age. They are carefully positioned so as to enliven the walker's winding path. Robert's painting perfectly catches this mood of enjoyable dereliction, controlled ruin. Art is the inspiration here, not nature. Carefully constructed by architects well-versed in the very latest techniques. For ideas. And from a thoroughly European concept of the Orient, pagodas sprout in English and French gardens. The pagoda of Chanteloup, near Framboise. Ingenuity and childlike playfulness. Rockeries, grottos, minarets, Turkish courtyards, mock Chinese landscapes.
The romantic garden featured gently melancholic ruins carefully designed to look at least 5 centuries old, or whimsical follies that pretended to be Chinese pagodas or Roman temples. The garden, though still, of course, private, aimed for a carefully tousled look and a sweep of landscape with no visible boundaries. They were still there, but the fences were replaced by unobtrusive but equally effective ditches into which people from time to time fell. Gardens bristled with jokes, puns, and gags. One of the better examples is the unconventional lantern at Bayreuth. This kind of make-believe vista remains a delightful period piece. The true significance of the Romantic garden lies with those artists who extended the garden's traditional boundaries to include all nature, the entire landscape. Instead of pruning nature down to size, writers and painters were for the first time overwhelmed by the force and richness of nature in the raw. The relationship between man and nature had undergone a crucial and irreversible change. The carefully created natural world of the rich man's garden feels the stirrings of a violent wind of change. The temples and the colonnades, the artificial lakes and mock waterfalls are blown away by the demand for the rawness and elemental power of the real thing. The images of confected and idealized nature shrivel into insignificance against the grandeur of torrents
and mountains. Rejecting the tidily winding paths of the romantic garden, the true romantic discovers the Alps. And in England, the rugged delights of the Scottish Highlands.
And now, what do you think of this wild region?
The stag becomes the romantic animal, king of these wild wastes, creature of myth and legend. In Sir Walter Scott's ballad, The Lady of the Lake, it is the stag who leads the hero ever onwards into a charmed land of highland scenery.
The antlered monarch of the waste sprung from his heathery couch in haste. But ere his fleet career he took, the dewdrops from his flanks he shook. Like crested leader, proud and high, tossed his beamed frontlet to the sky. A moment gazed adown the dale, a moment snuffed the tainted gale, a moment listened to the cry that thickened as the chase drew nigh. Then, as the headmost foes appeared, with one brave bound the copse he cleared, and stretching forward free and far, sought the wild heaths of Ullumbar.
The paintings of Sir Edwin Landseer embody the romantic view of wild heaths and noble beasts. Turner captures the awe-inspiring grandeur of the Highland scenery with an immediacy that rips through the purple clouds of the Victorian imagination. It is Walter Scott who guides Turner to the best viewpoints for his Scottish landscapes. And in his own poetry, Scott evokes the ferocity of the scenes he selected.
Seems the primeval earthquake's sway hath rent a strange and shattered way through the rude bosom of the hill, and that each naked precipice, sable ravine, and dark abyss tells of the outrage still.
Paradise Lost. The Romantic era marks the end of a tradition that had furnished the great houses of Europe with gardens creating heaven on earth. Paradise Regained. Instead of the man-made garden, people's eyes were opened to the grandeur of woods and hills and mountains. Rather than formal fountains, they began to admire waterfalls or country brooks. The paintings of John Constable, especially these small oil sketches from nature, celebrate the vigorous pleasures of the most humble and banal aspects of the world about him, of trees, clouds, skies, views on Hampstead Heath, dating from the time the painter moved to a house in Hampstead Village, and views of Flatford Mill in the Suffolk countryside, where he spent his boyhood.
The sound of water escaping from mill dams, willows, old rotten planks, shiny posts and brickwork. I love such things. As long as I do paint, I shall never cease to paint such places. Painting is with me but another word for feeling.
The English visionary painter Samuel Palmer saw paradise in the dumpy hills and rustic cottages of what is now a suburb of London, Dulwich, and in the neighbouring fields of Kent.
Considering Dulwich as the gate into the worlds of vision, one must try behind the hills to bring up a mystic glimmer like that which lights our dreams. And those same hills, hard task, should give us promise that the country behind them is paradise.
The true romantic garden is the natural garden, not the painstaking dishevelment of the great estates so delicately achieved at a price by Capability Brown, the 18th century landscaper, but the traditional garden of the English country cottage.
If my aspirations are very high, my depressions are very deep. So I may sometimes bound upwards, pierce the clouds, and look over the doors of bliss.